And for children 13 and older with severe obesity, they might want to consider bariatric surgery, weight loss surgery.
In this video, I am going to react to the American Pediatric Association's new recommendation for childhood obesity, and also to the absolutely irresponsible and horrible podcast that the New York Times did on this subject. Let's get started with the ridiculousness.
From the New York Times, I'm Michael Barbaro. This is The Daily. Today, the story behind sweeping and, to many, revolutionary new guidelines for how to treat millions of children with obesity. I spoke to my colleague, Gina Colada, about what led to the change.
Yeah, I can't wait to hear.
Of the recommendations from this group.
They're very sweeping. They involve examining a child as young as two and saying, does this child have obesity? If so, they advise intensive lifestyle counseling and treatment.
And children who are 12 years old or older.
Wait, did you hear that? Lifestyle counseling for a two-year-old. It's the friggin' parents that need the lifestyle counseling, not the child. Okay, wait, let's hear what they say about 12-year-olds. Can't wait for this.
And for children who are 12 years old or older and they have obesity, they say it is appropriate and recommended to prescribe a drug
that will help them. And for children 13 and older.
Wait. The recommendation of the American Pediatric Association is if a 12-year-old is obese, you start pumping them full of prescription medications. Quick time out here. There's a big problem in America with healthcare. People wonder why their insurance costs double every 3 years and why their doctor's appointments have gone from a 1 hour time slot to a 15 minute time slot. It's so that we can give bariatric surgery and expensive drugs to everyone for anything. Okay, it's just crazy to give prescription medication to 12-year-olds. I cannot wait to hear what we're gonna do for 13-year-olds.
And for children 13 and older with severe obesity, they might wanna consider bariatric surgery, weight loss surgery.
Aggressive.
You just heard that. This is crazy. They're recommending a irreversible surgery for gastric bypass for 13-year-olds who are obese. This is bonkers. As I was saying, this is exactly why our medical system and healthcare system in America is so screwed up. It's because of stupid decisions like this.
Forms of intervention for young people.
Absolutely. And I know their concern is that you can't ignore obesity. In general, it doesn't go away. Kids do not outgrow it. And once it gets started, it just persists through a lifetime and gets worse as the child gets older.
Yeah, if you keep doing stupid things and don't learn anything, it gets worse. There are a zillion great stories of people who were obese, learned about nutrition and lifestyle, and became lean and healthy for the rest of their lives without using drugs or bariatric surgery.
Especially for adults, obesity linked to a higher risk of diabetes, high blood pressure, and other issues. So would the American?
Yes, agreed. Obesity is the number one cause of death in America. No question. We do have to do something about it. But what they're saying is wrong.
The Academy of Pediatrics is saying, if you see obesity in a child, you just can't ignore it. You really can't. You've got to take action now.
What we're disagreeing about is the action that should be taken.
So how do we get to this point where this very influential group of doctors thinks that this level of intervention is required?
I'll tell you why. It's because the doctors in the American Pediatric Association are on the boards of big pharma and also for hospitals that do these procedures who stand to profit from 20% of these kids getting bariatric surgery. It's a gold mine, and you're going to pay for it because your insurance premiums will go up and your appointment times with your doctor will go from 15 minutes down to 7 minutes so that we can pay for all these ridiculous procedures when simple lifestyle changes and nutritional changes would solve the problem for most people. Jeez.
It's been a really long journey. It started back in the 1960s, sort of the babies that era. Around then, there was not much obesity. Only 5% of children and adolescents had obesity. So people just said, okay, well, you know, some kids are chubby and most of them will outgrow it. It was not on anybody's agenda as a big issue.
Mm-hmm.
But then in the 1970s, and especially...
By the way, I was one of those chubby kids. My parents told me this like 40 years after the fact. But when I was like 9, I was so chubby they were concerned about it. They started me in swim club, which I didn't realize it was just for me to get exercise. I actually loved it. And lo and behold, I was no longer a chubby kid anymore.
Actually, in the 1980s, the rate of obesity really picked up. Instead of 5%, 10% of children and adolescents had obesity.
We always say that a fat baby is a healthy baby, but that's an idea we should change.
People were starting to say, we have an obesity epidemic here.
Ideally,
I'm ready with the
calories you take in each day, just about equal the calories you use.
And thought with, well, you know, change the diet. Diet foods started coming up.
This ties in well to the video I did recently about our diet beverages making you obese. They do not help in losing
diet
fat.
Diet Coke, Fresca. A diet everything.
Right.
That's sugar.
We make Cheerios, no sugar. Kids make Cheerios number one.
Artificial sugars and things.
That's the only part of my diet I can really stick to.
Don't eat that much sugar. Exercise more. This should not be an issue. You just have to get people moving and tell them to eat fewer calories and everything will be fine.
So in this era, it sounds like obesity in children is seen as a question of lifestyles and decisions and choices that are made, choices that are bad or choices that are good.
Absolutely. But even with all this focus on diet foods and proper nutrition and getting out and exercising, the problem was just not going away. And in fact, it was getting worse.
All this attention. Eating right is not drinking diet sodas and having diet products. That is not good nutrition. This is the problem. Jeez.
So in the 1990s, people said, well, maybe we could do some interventions and see what would happen if we did a large study and try to see if we do everything that we think will make a difference, are we right? So the National Institutes of Health had spent a lot of money on two large and rigorous studies, and they said, let's randomize schools. Some schools are the control schools. Don't touch the kids there. Everything's the same. Mm-hmm. The other schools, they had a whole lot more physical education. They brought in special teachers to exercise with kids. They made cafeteria meals more nutritious. They got rid of sugary sodas.
All good.
They fattening meals in the cafeteria. They taught children about proper nutrition and why they had to exercise. They brought the parents in. There was no difference in the kids' weights.
Wow.
Okay, this is so obvious to me, and I'm pissed that Michael Barbara did not call the guest out on this. It doesn't matter how much exercise you do, you can always out-eat your exercise and become fat. And if you look at the details of the study, when they say they brought parents in, that was totally insufficient. The thing is, they changed what they could at school. The kids exercised. They didn't add after-school programs. They didn't teach the kids how to cook healthy meals. They just provided them one meal a day. One meal a day is not going to make you lose fat. The thing is, what matters is what the kids are eating at home, because that's where 75% to 80% of their calories come from. And they did not teach the parents about nutrition. They did not teach the parents how to cook healthy meals. That is the problem. They did not change the lifestyle and nutrition of the children. You gotta teach the parents how. I mean, is this rocket science?
But why didn't it work? What was the conclusion that—
I just told you why.
The research
and the fact that you didn't teach the parents how to cook and provide healthy, low-calorie meals.
It doesn't.
Blame it on genetics. Oh, that's it. I'm obese because I have bad genetics. I need a gastric bypass and lots of $1,000 a month prescriptions. That's the solution. There are certain conditions that cause people to gain fat. I've covered this many times before. People who have severe depression or anxiety, that causes fat gain. The medications that you take to make life livable with those conditions also cause fat gain. Yes, there's a big genetic component to both depression and anxiety. But as far as I have the obesity gene, that is bullshit. For normal people, it is calories in and calories out. People cannot defy the laws of thermodynamics. If you decrease the caloric intake below the energy expenditure, you will lose fat. There is no alternative. This is not a alternative fifth dimension on Star Trek. Kids learn how to eat from their parents. It's no wonder that obese parents have obese children, because they feed their children just like they feed themselves. Yes, it's genetic, I guess, when you look at it that way. Okay, Michael Barbaro, New York Times, gets called out for this bullshit. They're basically just enabling the American Pediatric Association to use them as a free commercial for promoting expensive diet medications and expensive gastric bypasses. I covered this before. That's bullshit. The only reason they made obesity a disease is because if you have a disease code in the ICD, then doctors can bill for it and then insurance companies have to pay for it, which again is why your insurance keeps going up and your appointments keep getting shorter and shorter, because more and more things that are actually within our control to change are marked as diseases so that they can be billed to your insurance.
Wrong.
Yes, it has been wrong, but not in the way you suggest. What's wrong is that we have never taught kids in school how to cook nutritious meals and to learn about good nutrition. Home ec used to be a place to make cakes and cookies. That's not what I'm talking about, learning how to cook. I'm talking about how to cook black bean chili from scratch, for example. Remember, we're talking about two-year-olds here. You don't need to include the parents. You need to have it only for the parents. They are 100% responsible. Two-year-olds do not make decisions. Parents do for their two-year-old child. So what they're suggesting here, this 26 hours of intense training and intervention, is true, but it needs to be exclusively for the parents. Maybe we should teach nutrition in schools. I can't believe we're talking about this. Giving 12-year-olds a prescription that they'll be on for life, because once you start depending on a prescription to keep your weight down, it's literally the rest of your life. I can just see Big Pharma squealing with glee when they're listening to this podcast. It's like, yippee, our stock is going through the roof. A third of America is going to be on our $1,000 a month prescription for the rest of their life, and insurance is going to pay for it. No, everyone's going to pay for it, because our insurance premiums are going to double every year.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's okay.
Then. And you know, so they don't stay in the hospital long. It doesn't have a long recovery time.
Whoopee!
Once you have it, it's forever. You have it the rest of your life. You cannot reverse it. You can't say, I want my old intestines back. It's gone.
If we're doing something irreversible on a child, it's a big decision.
It is a huge decision.
Hell yeah.
Yes.
So given the enormity of some of the interventions we're talking about, especially the surgery, what have been the reactions to these recommendations?
What my reaction? Yep. Remember what I said. This is corporate America making more money. Again, it's these doctors on the American Pediatric Association who made these recommendations are on the boards of the hospitals that make money off bariatric surgeries, and they're on the boards of Big Pharma who stand to profit from a third of children being put on a $1,000 a month medication for life.
Therapy, the medication that would be out of reach for many people.
Heaven forbid you consider learning how to cook and provide nutritious meals for your kids rather than spend $1,000 a month on medication or destroy their intestines with surgery. Heaven forbid.
And not everybody with obesity has health problems.
And just explain that. I mean, that seems like an important sentence. Not everybody with obesity has health problems.
There are people with obesity who do not have diabetes, do not have high blood pressure, who do not have any of the things that people are saying. And a lot of people are healthy. So,
oh, God. There's so much BS going on here. My sensor is pegged. There is not one person on the planet who is healthier at 300 pounds than they would be at 200 pounds, period. I don't care. They might not be dead yet, but they will be soon.
What you've told us about genetic research, that's just simply not the case.
Absolutely.
Okay, bullshit. It has nothing to do with virtue. It has nothing to do with genetics. In most cases, unless it's a mental issue, it's all about nutritional knowledge and lifestyle. That's what we know.
So is the thinking, Gina, that recommendations like this are liberating and cathartic for children and for their families?
Of course, it's telling them it's not their fault. You poor thing, you have the obesity disease. You need to take these $1,000 a month pills and get this $50,000 bariatric surgery. You poor thing, you couldn't do anything.
Because it says to them all, we know how hard this is, and we know that this is a disease, and we know that the only real solution is to act early and aggressively, and that, in a sense, unburdens people.
That's my hope. My hope is that if people actually know about, understand, and believe what the pediatricians are saying, it could destigmatize obesity. Children with obesity should not be stigmatized any more than a child with another chronic disease.
No, which is why we should teach their parents about lifestyle and nutrition in school.
It's like diabetes, asthma, anything else. It's not their fault. It's a disease.
It's their parents' fault.
Taken seriously.
Right. And
it's not a disease.
These recommendations are, in that sense, at long last, meeting that reality where it is.
Yes, that's what I think.
Well, Gina, thank you very much. We appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
It was a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you for spewing bullshit for an hour. So, there you have it. The New York Times giving the American Pediatric Association, Big Pharma, and healthcare providers a free marketing piece telling everyone that one-third of children should be given $1,000 a month prescriptions and $50,000 bariatric surgery. Again, this is exactly why healthcare in America is so screwed up and why our insurance premiums are going to continue to double every 3 years while people get unhealthier by the year. Thanks for watching. Auf Wiedersehen.